midweek service. Let's all stand and go into prayer and prepare our hearts. Well, hopefully they're already prepared. Hopefully you came prepared. How about that? Isn't that the way we should arrive at church? We shouldn't have to prepare once we get here. We should just enter in, right? And I don't know about you, but I can use some praise and worship of our Lord tonight in this middle of the week in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you love us. God, we thank you, Lord, that in your presence there is fullness of joy. And so tonight, God, we call upon you to fill this place. Fill us with your presence. As we lift our voices in praise and worship to you, Lord, descend upon us as you promised you would, that where we gather in your name, you're going to be in our midst. When we praise your name, you will inhabit us. So we declare and we say tonight, God, inhabit us as we worship you and give you honor and praise. And we ask it all in the glorious name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Let's worship him tonight. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Do you live to praise the Lord tonight? If you do, just give him a big wave offering if you would. Oh, how good it is to sing praises to our God. How great it is to sing about.
How good it is to sing praises to our God. Of everything this world has to offer, I can honestly say I'd rather have Jesus. I'd rather have Jesus than fame and fortune. I'd rather have his peace and his love. I'd rather have Jesus than gold or silver. I won't be satisfied in anything but him. If that's your testimony, let's give him a hand clap of praise all over the house. Lord, we'd rather have you today. We'd rather have you in our lives. Amen. You may have your seats. Praise God. Amen. I remember telling the Lord one day when things had got rough in my life with my wife and my children, and as I was driving to work, the enemy gave me a flash of everything he could offer me if I just walked away from my walk with him. And I remember crying to the loudest if I can cry in that car, I'd rather have Jesus. Anything you could show me, I'd rather have Jesus. And he left that temptation. He left me, amen. But I'd rather have Jesus today. I wanna welcome you again to Harvest Midweek Service, where we're studying on Apostle Paul. Do we have any first timers in our Wednesday night service? Anyone for the first time in our Wednesday night service? Anyone out there? Well, we'll praise God for you that continue to come through our Wednesday night study. I just want to highlight a couple of announcements before I take up tonight's tithe and offering. Our first announcement, we're going to continue with Financial Peace University on tomorrow at 7. Actually, we'll be studying on real estate and mortgage. Amen. Going to talk about those bad loans and good loans and what you should turn down and what you should strive for. We're having a great time in that class. And on this Saturday at 9 to 1, we're having a church-wide, all hands, work day. Amen. On the ship, they used to call it happy hour. So you come on Saturday morning from 9 to 1, and we're going to have happy hours. Amen. We want to ask you if you have some lawn equipment. We're looking for if you have tools like weed eaters, trimmers, edgers, chainsaws, wheelbarrows, if you can bring them. We got a truck, bring those. They're being great. We'll be using those, and we have a good, great need for them. Also, if you have gloves, please bring out your gloves and sweep. Swiffer. That's like a broom and a mop all in one. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I got an old swab at the house I still use. Amen. But if you have anything that you think will be of help, bring it with you. We don't have to send people back out or to the store, especially if you got gloves and those trimmers and edgers. If you got, I believe we might have a young man coming out with his power washer. But if you have a power washer, you can throw in the truck, bring it just in case you need it. Amen. So please come. We won't be here but 4 hours, and at 1 o'clock it'll be pizza time. Amen. Next announcement, churchwide prayer this Sunday at 6 p.m. Won't be here for but 1 hour. We can come in and we pray and watch God move, and you still have a little daylight left on the other end. Amen. It probably will cool down a little bit. You can do some little yard work after. Also, want a reminder, as coming up for Resurrection Sunday, we will be having a resurrection offering. That's over and above our tithe and offering. We only ask you for special offerings, I think twice a year, and these are one of the times. And we're going to, so be praying about what you want to give for a resurrection offering. Amen. Last announcement is, we're still looking for volunteers for Sunday morning nursery and children's church. I didn't see a sign-up sheet in the lobby, but if you go out there, you don't see one, let myself know or Miss Robbie, a pastor, know that you want to volunteer. And you have it out there? Amen. Miss Tammy will have it out there. And these are your announcements. Amen. Let's make ready to receive our tithe and offering for the night. Our offering scripture is from Proverbs 3, 9, and 10. And it reads, I got a backup. Amen. Old King James Version. Amen. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase. So your barns will be full with plenty, and your vats will overflow with new wine. Amen. Honor the Lord with everything you own. Man, it reminds me of a story that a missionary told about. So he was over in Africa, and he was teaching the villagers about tithing and offering. He had taught a lesson on tithing. He said, God wants you to give your first fruits. Amen. And one of the young men left the service and came back with a fish. He said, missionary, I want to give you my tithe. He said, this is your tithe? He said, yes, sir. He said, well, where are the other 9 fish? He said, I hadn't caught them yet. They're still out there in the river. I just want to give you the first fruit. Amen. So he trusted the Lord was going to provide. So he took the man at his word. He brought the first fruit, the first fish he caught. He brought it to the man of God. Amen. And I believe God honored that word. Let us pray. Father, we thank you tonight. We thank you for the song that we sang and the worship to you. That we rather have you. We rather have your presence. You rather have your love. We rather have your peace. And Lord, we ask you right now that your love and peace be resonated here in service. And Lord, as we give in our offering, we honor you with our possessions. We honor you with our first fruit. We honor you with everything you've given us. And Lord, as we give in this offering, Lord, we ask you to show yourself mighty, to multiply like you did the fish and the loaves, to provide for this house, provide for the ministries, provide for your work. And Lord, we give you glory, honor, and praise for what you've been doing and what you will do. And everyone says amen, amen, amen. After you have given, we have a video of a new song that we'll be singing in the near future. So we want to sing together one of the new songs. It should be a video on that song. Hallelujah.
He is the Lion and the Lamb. Praise the Lord. We give you thanks. Y'all are Pavlovian. Y'all know what that means. The song ends and you just automatically sit down. You just knew. You didn't even give me a chance. While you're seated, turn around and high-five somebody in a very uncomfortable position because you sat down already. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Woo. So I'm anticipating, are we still having problems with scripture slides, or we're all good? Okay. It's just Proverbs? Yeah. Devil don't want us to be wise, so trying to keep wisdom from coming into us. We're going to be in Acts chapter number 14 tonight, continuing the story of Paul and looking at his life. We're going to be there for a little while. Before we do that, though, I want to share a testimony, and I believe we should give God thanks for big things and for maybe some things that don't appear big, but I believe we should always take time to give God thanks. And I may ask some of you if you have something you want to give the Lord thanks for tonight. But as you know, Tammy has been battling with this issue with swallowing, and that battle is continuing, but we're believing God is healing in the name of Jesus. But I mean, when you're feeling something like that and the doctor tells you it's going to be May before they can do a procedure on you, that's a little disheartening. You get a little encouraged when they say, well, we can move it up to 2 weeks. We'll get you in April the 10th. And so you feel good about that for just a second. Then you think, wait a minute, that's two more weeks. And you got a golf ball to baseball size feeling in your throat and you can't swallow anything thicker than tomato soup. Well, today, I went by there to talk to them. I mean, you know what that means. I went by there to talk to them, and before we left out of there, the Lord had opened up an appointment for Monday for our abdominal procedure. Amen. Of course, we're believing that before Monday, that thing's going to open up in the name of Jesus. Amen. And because what she's having done on Monday is diagnostic, and you know what that means. They diagnose, and then what? Yeah. So we're continuing to pray. And then when she goes to pick up the prescribed medication, how many of y'all heard the phrase, good things come to those who wait? Well, she had to wait. It was supposed to be done when she got there, and she had to wait a really, really, really long time before they filled it. They couldn't find it. And then when they filled it, now this is unheard of in my life. I've never heard of this. When they filled it, they gave her the medicine for free. Hallelujah. Praise God. Have you ever heard of a pharmacy doing that? Because they made you wait? Yeah? Oh, some of you? No, not just for waiting, maybe for some other things, but not just for waiting. But anyway, I thank God for the blessings of heaven. Amen. A moved up appointment and not having to pay anything for the medicine. No payments at all. So we thank God for that. We give him praise. Anybody else have a testimony they'd like to share tonight of the goodness of God? Big, little, small, in between? Yes, ma'am. Your voice is powerful, it's just not loud.
Well, this is really Johnny's testimony, but Sunday we weren't here at church, but we were so thrilled because our young neighbor, a young man who had been struggling with drugs and violence and gangs and beating up his mother and all kinds of a bad thing about a year ago, Johnny and I helped him get into Teen Challenge. And it's a year program, and a bunch of people started, and this Sunday, he graduated.
Oh, praise the Lord.
After a year, he was one of two who completed the program.
Wow.
And out of 40-some that started, so we're just giving God the glory. He's got a great future now, and full of the Lord, oh my goodness. He's like a different person.
Hallelujah. We praise the Lord for that. Amen. Amen. Yes, ma'am.
So I guess, as you know, Jordan was admitted into the hospital.
Yeah.
Last Wednesday after we left church, he had 104.8 degree fever. And they said he has a kidney infection and had poop bacteria, where it shouldn't be. And so I missed a couple days of work, and I let my manager know what was going on and everything. And I went back to work today, and well, first, obviously, he's fine.
Yes, out of the hospital praise the God other day. For that. Yeah.
But my coworkers had come together and got me a $200 little gift card to go get him some stuff. And it was really sweet.
Yes, amen.
And he is completely better.
Amen. Praise God for that. Now, here's a really important question. Did he get some chocolate?
Yes,
yes he did. I went up to see him, and they were gone for a procedure, so I just left two chocolate bars on his pillow with a little note because I heard he loved chocolate. So did you enjoy that chocolate? Yeah? Yeah, there's a little smile. Y'all can't see it, but I can see it. Anyway, oh, I see Mr. Mann standing. Wait, I'm bringing you this. I don't know, but
today, Judy and I went in for a CAT scan for myself, and this is the first time it's really gone smoother. I don't know if you've ever had a CAT scan, but that thing is right above your nose.
And yes, sir.
I get claustrophobia from those things.
Yes,
but today it went so smooth, I just thank the Lord for it, brother.
That's right, amen. And the report coming out of it's going to be smooth too, amen? Amen. How many of you have been in a CAT scan machine before? How many of you have to just close your eyes and just put it out? Yeah, man. I just have to close my eyes and pretend that thing's not there. And I thank God that he helps see us through. Anybody else a testimony you want to share? I see another hand. Oh, yes, ma'am. Just hold it right there. You don't have to hold it all the way up. But
I'm going to try to get through this without crying my eyeballs out. But I've been so full of fear today. I got a text from, I thought it was this ministry. And I was hurting this morning, and I was in need of prayer. And just all of a sudden, I get this text. But this text came through as like just put this fear in me, like unbelievable about my family, there'd be sickness and this and that, and about fasting and praying, and I needed to do it at a certain time, and I needed to give to this orphanage, and I was just so full of fear. And I'm a single woman, and a lot of things in my family, and I've just moved out here, and I have no one out here, and I'm like, oh Lord, it's Wednesday night, thank you Jesus, they might be having my Bible study, and I have to work most of the time, so I'm not able to get here on Wednesday night, but I just thank God that I'm here. I
amen.
Have peace now.
Amen. And you do have family here.
Yes.
They're sitting all around you now. Amen. What a great thing to know. And we're so glad you're here, Annette. Amen. Amen. And we'll talk about that text and other things, but that is not yours. You don't claim it. You don't walk in that in the name of Jesus. Amen. Somebody else. Yes, sir. I was hoping you'd raise your hand.
I told him he didn't.
You were. You got a choice.
Me and my family have been going through a lot of sickness since February, really. I'd passed kidney stones, and I was sick with the flu at the same time, and my wife and my kids were all sick. Then come here in March, they got all sick again. And then, you know, we're all starting to recover. You know,
hallelujah.
Just kind of off and on, but mine kind of lingered, kind of, you know, and the kind of work I do, I work with Boyettes, if y'all don't know what that is. We clean Port-a-John units. So you're exposed to, I'm exposed to a lot
when
it comes to that kind of stuff. So I never did fully heal, but I got sick again, and it was bad. I couldn't hardly even stand. I called in Monday morning, and my boss was already losing his best guys. The best guys put his notice in to leave, moved to Virginia, and he see I'm sick, and he's just real frustrated. So he decided he's going to fire me. And, you know,
hang on for the rest of the story.
Everybody went into prayer and everything, you know, and he had told me that, he said, I called him back up and told him, you know, I really need this job and everything, you know, and he knows I'm a good worker. And I think he knew I was really sick, but everybody started praying, you know, and I was supposed to call him 6 in the morning on Tuesday morning, and he ended up calling me a little bit after 5, said, Daniel, I need you to come in. So I still got my job. And
hallelujah. Amen. Amen. and getting well in the name of Jesus. And we'll have prayer over you tonight. God is faithful. When he told me that tonight, I was so happy because I knew that they'd been walking through a lot of sickness. Somebody else, come on, we're getting good testimony tonight.
This year, Todd's stepdad passed away, and we had been praying so hard for his mom, and every time we had talked to her, she sounded like she was 100, and she had no hope, and she has just been so depressed and stuff like that, and it's just been almost, she just gave up, and it's just been really hard just to even talk to her. Well, a couple weeks ago, we called her, and it's just like, her voice, we got her back. She still misses her husband. She's still grieving, but she's back. She's taken back her life. She sounds like our mom again.
Yeah.
And we've just been praying so hard. And, you know, sometimes you pray and you're just like, well, God, you know, maybe it isn't going to happen this time. Maybe this time with this person, it's not going to happen. You know, yeah. You get the devil puts that in your mind. And you all want to go shake him and say, God loves you so much, you know, but you can't do that. And it's just like... But he answered the prayer.
Hallelujah.
So we get to go see her in May.
And, yay.
And we're all excited.
Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Yes, ma'am.
I got a job.
How about that for a testimony? Woo-hoo! Praise God. How about anybody else? We've been praying with Vicki for a little while about a job, and God has opened up the door, and we are grateful and thankful for that. Amen. Amen. Anyone else got a testimony they want to share tonight? I'm going to share one for Todd. Todd got his badge to be able to go to Camp 5, and he was back there last night. And I guess they wore you out singing last night, didn't they? Being able to bring that guitar back in there. And I believe Cliff was there last night, and George and Chris were there, so we thank God for that. Anybody else? Come on. It's great to have Jerry and Debbie back home. They took a vacation to be sick, I guess, and God bless their hearts. Everybody was sick except Jerry, but we're glad. Apparently, they got down there and shared it all among themselves, but we're very glad that they're back home, and Debbie as well. I asked her tonight, "Are you well, sister?" She said, "I'm well tonight." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, a couple of more. Somebody else has got a testimony. You know what the Word of God says? You overcome them by the blood of the Lamb and what? The word of your testimony.
Mine's happy.
Yay.
I'm going to be a grandma for the second time. And I don't know if you know my son, John, but, you know, he only had 2 children. One passed away in July, and then so all I had left was John. And so he moved to go to a private college up in Missouri to be a minister. And he graduates the 6th of May. And so I, you know, am single as well, you know, and I have Isabel. And I don't make a whole lot of money. So I was worried about getting there. So he talked to me today and told me he had me 2 buddy passes from Mr. Rick Bester.
Yes.
So that was a blessing because now I can go and be able to enjoy the week that I'm going to have with them and, you know, cuddle with my new grandbaby. And Sierra is having some issues, but the baby's far along that the baby will be healthy if they have to induce tomorrow or, you know, induce or whatever tomorrow because her blood pressure's gone spiked up and she looks kind of balloonish in the face. And so I just wanted to, you know, since my daughter passed away, I was really, really down. And, you know, but just things have started just to, God has just given me a new life.
Hallelujah.
And John, you know, I felt kind of abandoned of him, you know, for a while because, you know, he's my love, you know, my baby. And, you know, he's doing so well, and he called, and he's like, things are just getting back to a normal life for me.
Yes, Jesus.
And God has just really, really taken a lot of that sadness away and brought me like a new life.
Joy.
I mean, I don't know how to explain it, but then it's like a new beginning, a last chapter of my life, you know, because I'm getting old.
No, that's not happening. For those of you who may not put the connection together, Ruth's son John is married to Rick and Jody Bestian's daughter Sierra. And so that's the big family connection there as well. And I love watching Sierra, or reading Sierra's posts on Facebook. She is a radical mama. That's what I've got to say. So let's be in prayer for her too, that everything goes smooth for her and the baby. All right, at least one more. Somebody's got it. There's at least one. Okay.
That, you know, you felt like you had no family here in Florida. My husband and I are not from here, and we had been here since 2014 from Washington State, and our family is in Louisiana. It's just different states, and so we, for a long time, we felt like we were alone and we had nobody. And I had been praying God would send us to a church where we felt loved and felt like we can depend on people to pray for us, because we felt like we were carrying burdens by ourselves and we really needed some backup, you know, to fight for us, to help us. And you are not alone in this church, because there are women in this church that pray, and I feel the prayers. And I don't know if you have Facebook, but we have the Women's Harvest, and you know, you, every time you got a need in there, you put it in there, and there's people popping up praying. And it's really encouraging to know that whatever you're going through, you're not alone, and you have people praying for you, and you can count on that, knowing that you're not by yourself, and that you have other prayers going up, because more prayers means pushing God, you know, to hear those and answering prayers. So you are loved, and yeah, it's big family here.
Amen. Amen. Mia, Annette, Mia. So, all right. We're going to try to really quickly, unless somebody else has one. I don't want to leave anybody else out. Okay. See, I thought there might be.
For over a year now, Ray and I have been kind of having relationship problem with our children. And God is beginning to restore our children's relationship with us. So I believe by the end of this year, I'm going to take that back. Within 3 months, our relationship with our children will be restored.
Amen.
And I'm going to claim that right now and thanking God for it.
Amen. And the first fruits is already here, right? Amen. Yeah, First Fruits was sitting right here and testified about the little boy. So we see God at work already, and we thank God for that. Okay, I'm going to pause for just another second to see if I'm missing anybody else. Y'all are thinking he ain't going to be able to teach tonight. I teach fast. Some of y'all looking at the clock already. Pastor's on the clock. Yes, ma'am.
Those of you who know me know my mother has been ill, and we thought at one point that she was on a downward climb, but not my mama. She's tough, and I'm going to be able to bring her to my home, and she's going to spend some time with my husband and my son and I.
Hallelujah.
So she'll be 93.
Wow.
April 13th. Our birthdays were 10 minutes apart. She was mad at the doctor because he didn't put it together, but anyway. So I'm just thankful that we're going to have some time with her again to
amen
just have her with us.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And you know what that speaks to me too? You got good genes, so you're going to be with us a long time, sister. You're going to be with us a long time. All right, anybody else? Going once, going twice. All right, Acts chapter number 14. Thank you for sharing that. How many of you are encouraged after people share their testimonies that way? I mean, that is just the buildup within the body of Christ. God is a good God. Come on, let's give God a good hand clap of praise in His house tonight. We ended last week very quickly trying to finish up chapter 13 before we walked out the door. So the last few verses of 13 says, but the Jews stirred up devout and prominent women and the chief men of the city, raised up persecution against Paul and Barnabas, and expelled them from their region. But they shook off the dust from their feet against them and came to Iconium, and the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. So even in opposition, you still continue to serve God. You do what God says to do, and God will fill you with joy and with His Holy Spirit. And I like that whole thing. If they don't receive you, just knock the dust off your feet and keep on going. God has another place, another thing for you to do. And then now we're going to pick up in chapter number 14. These first three verses I'll read real quickly. It says, now it happened in Iconium that they went together to the synagogue of the Jews and spoke to a great multitude, both of the Jews and of the Greeks. And a great multitude of the Jews and Greeks believed. But the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their mind against the brethren. And before they stayed there a long time, speaking boldly in the Lord, who was bearing witness to the world of His grace, granting signs and wonders to be done by their hands. So they left a place of trouble, they went to the next place and immediately began to preach. That is the story of Paul's life. Everywhere he went, he shared the gospel. And everywhere he went where he shared the gospel in the first century church, it upset folks. How many of you believe it upsets folks today to share the gospel? Amen? The world and the culture is just at odds with the gospel. And when we share it, we see and we know and we understand what it means when we declare the gospel, that the world is going to come against it. And what should we do in those cases? Say again? Keep sharing the gospel. What's some other things we do in the midst of that? Persevere. How about counting it a privilege and honor and a joy that we are suffering persecution or resistance for the sake of the cross? Amen. We suffer a lot of resistance in a lot of different ways, but when you suffer for the sake of the gospel and for the sake of the cross, that brings honor and glory to God. Amen. I say this all the time when I say that, though. Don't go seeking out trouble and opposition. If you just declare the Word of God and live your life out loud for Jesus, there will be those who will not like what you do, but this is what you do. You keep sharing it anyway. And if you have to leave that place, God says, forget about it, knock the dust off your feet, and move on. Verse 4 says, but the multitude of the city was divided, part sided with the Jews, part with the apostles, and with a violent attempt was made by both the Gentiles and Jews with their rulers to abuse and stone them. They became aware of it and fled to Lystra and Derbe, cities of Lycaonia, and to the surrounding region, and they were preaching the gospel there. So again, they're run out of this place, they're afraid to stay. The principle is, let's go and let's just preach the gospel where we go. Hallelujah. How many of you know that needs to be our attitude and our mind? That we're going to live the gospel in our jobs. We're going to live the gospel in our homes and in our neighborhoods. We're going to live the gospel everywhere we go. And if it's received, we give God glory. And if it's not received, we give God glory. And we continue to live the gospel, preach the gospel, share the gospel. Then when they got to Lystra, there was a problem. Now, I'm not going to read all these verses 8 through 18, but there was a problem that was going on there, and because they were idol worshipers, and when Paul and Barnabas showed up with great authority, remember this is the first century church, so they're not used to anything like this. When they showed up, does anybody know what happened? They started calling Barnabas Zeus and started calling Paul Hermes. Because they were idol worshipers, they were Greeks, they had these Greek gods. How many of you knew before tonight that Zeus's name was in the Bible? Yeah. Zeus's name is right there in verse 12. It says, and Barnabas they called Zeus, and Paul Hermes, because Paul was the chief speaker. Then the priest of Zeus, whose temple was in front of their city, brought oxen and garlands to the gates, intending to sacrifice with the multitudes. So they came with such authority that these people reacted to them in the only way that they knew, according to their culture. They thought Zeus and Hermes had showed up in their midst. And Zeus was the powerful. He was the ruler. Now, how many of you find it odd that they thought Barnabas was Zeus and not Paul? Why would that be? Now, this is our thought-provoking question of the evening. Why would it be that they considered Paul to be Hermes and Barnabas to be Zeus. All right, now when I share you, you're going to realize, oh, that's kind of practical, but anybody want to hazard a guess? Say again? They were Greek gods, and so they associated them, but why would they choose Barnabas to be Zeus, the ruler, the main god, the more powerful god, over Paul, whom we know to be the man? No, with their size, it was because, remember, Barnabas was Paul's instructor. He was Paul's senior in this whole journey because Barnabas had been a believer longer than Paul. And so as they traveled together, Barnabas must have carried himself in such a way. This is part of it. There's another very practical reason for the other part. But he carried himself in such a way that they identified him with Zeus and identified Paul as the god of Hermes, the god Hermes of the Greek mythology. And the reason they identified Paul as Hermes is because Paul was the speaker. And Hermes, when you look up Hermes in Greek mythology and things of that nature, he was the emissary or the messenger of the gods. So what they were saying about Paul is that Paul is the messenger of the gods. Well, then later in those verses, we see where they went into those people and tried to straighten them out and tell them, look, we are men just like you, but we come to you with this incredible message of the gospel. And some believed, but some still wanted and did sacrifice to them because they believed in the culture of that day that they were the personification of those gods. So the early church experienced some really strange reactions to the gospel. And I know we do today too, but not to the extent that they did, because this was a strange, for us, the message has been going on for 2,000 years. For them, it was all brand new. It was all new. So when we read, yes, ma'am. What was happening? Now, what would we equate that to? Zeus and Hermes showing up on earth. What today, what would we say that would be? What kind of activity would that be? Supernatural what? I heard somebody say it. Demonic activity, right? If they're not God or Jesus or the Holy Spirit, they can only be from one other source. Yes, ma'am. Yeah. And I thought about that as I was studying and preparing for this. How does that happen still today that some people that start out carrying the gospel get it twisted because some people come to them and say, you are incredible. You're all that in a bag of chips. You know, you're something else. And then they begin to believe all of that. And then the true gospel gets twisted into their own gospel and horrible things begin to happen. So, you know, when I was young in the faith and even young in the ministry, I never equated. People are always trying to prove that what is said in the Bible is real and genuine and it really did happen. Well, things like this actually lend, not that God needs any help in proving His word, please understand me, but to academics and to researchers, things like this actually lend credence to the truth of the Word of God, that people felt like Zeus and Hermes were actually showing up in the person of Barnabas and Paul. So, but we know clearly that was not the case. But the first century church encountered things unlike anything we ever did. And I'm thankful today for the perseverance of the first century church and the apostles and those that went out like Barnabas and Paul, that when they got run out of town or when there was threatening to take their life, they just moved on, knocked the dust off their feet, and just continued to preach the gospel until it spread across the entire world. Then in 19 and 20, they wanted to stone them, and here's what happened. And we'll end tonight study with this. It says this in verse 19, then Jews from Antioch and Iconium came there And having persuaded the multitudes, they stoned Paul and dragged him out of the city, supposing him to be dead. However, when the disciples gathered around him, he rose up and went into the city, and the next day he departed with Barnabas to Derbe. And the reason I want to end with this is the premise of, I bet they wish they'd have stayed there and made sure Paul was dead. Because really all they did was make Paul mad. And he began to serve God with even more energy and more fervor. Because they tried, he didn't look at it as them trying to end his life. He looked at it as them trying to stop the promulgation of the gospel into the Gentile world. And Paul then began to accomplish even more than what he had accomplished before. I had a pastor friend of mine share that message one time, and he had been through quite a bit of stuff in his life, and he said, I'm going to tell you something, they should have killed me when they had a chance. Because now I'm just mad. And now I'm going to declare the gospel with greater passion, with greater urgency, with greater fervor than ever before. How many of you have been through things in your life that you felt like the devil was trying to destroy you over? Can I tell you what? Rise up from that, knock the dust off your feet, and get mad at the devil and say, okay, you tried to take me out. You tried to silence my testimony. You tried to silence what God has done for me. I'm going to serve him greater than I've ever served him before. I'm going to declare his word greater than I've ever declared it before. I'm not afraid of you. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. And I'm going on. And you're going to be sorry. You're going to be sorry you didn't take me out. And you say, well, isn't that like challenging the devil? Don't worry about the devil. God's got you. God has got us. But this is where Paul was. If they had wiped him out there, who knows how long it would have taken to accomplish the things that were accomplished by Paul. But the enemy does that to us a lot of times through situations and things in our life. He thinks he's got us destroyed. And sometimes we may even feel that way for a little bit. We feel like it's done. But I want to declare to you today, be Paul in your spirit. Let the Holy Spirit raise you up and say, you know what? You should have finished it while you had a chance, but I still got breath in my lungs that God has given me, and I'm going to live, I'm going to speak, I'm going to declare the gospel everywhere I go in a greater way than I've ever had before. I think it's time we get mad at the devil and get mad at the right thing. And the right thing to get mad at is the enemy and all of his plans and his schemes. Amen? He ain't taking you out yet. God's still giving you breath in your lungs. Let's declare the gospel. Amen? Amen. Father, seal that word in our lives tonight as we continue our journey with Paul. And we will give you thanks and praise for all of that in the name of Jesus. Amen.